We've known for decades the unhealthy consequences that can happen because of excess weight, heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, and now cancer. The association between obesity and certain cancers is a relatively new area of research. Scientists are slowly starting to piece together various parts of the puzzle. To delve deeper into this topic, we set up shop at a recent conference held at Cleveland's brand new convention center. It was the 2013 Cleveland Clinic Medical Innovation Summit, dedicated to the topic of obesity. Producer Kay Colby had a chance to sit down with two experts who served on a panel at the summit about the association between cancer and obesity.
So I'm here with Dr. Nathan Berger of Case Western Reserve University School of Medicine, former dean, and also Hannah Payne, Professor of Experimental Medicine. Welcome. And Dr. Dale Shepard, Taussig Cancer Institute from the Cleveland Clinic. Welcome. So I want to start out talking about, people are going to be really surprised about this connection between obesity and cancer. I mean, we've heard about the heart disease, we've heard about the diabetes, but cancer puts it on a kind of different level. Why is that?
Cancer is a much more acute disease, and so it's more fulminant. That's sort of why it's somewhat more important. The association of cancer with obesity became more exposed to the public starting in about 1999 when, as a result of the American Cancer Society big study on 900,000 patients, they saw that there was a clear association between higher incidence of some kinds of cancer and obesity, and also worse prognosis or greater death rate of some kinds of cancer associated with obesity.
So it puts it on a different playing field just because it is such a scary disease. And Dr. Shepard, we heard earlier in the stories about the connection with endometrial cancer, esophageal cancer. What are some other types of cancer that obesity is connected with?
Yeah, I think there's some other cases out there that we can look to. Certainly colon cancer, there's some data. Question about breast cancer, particularly postmenopausal breast cancer. Possibility of prostate cancer being another cancer that might be at increased incidence.
And kidney and liver as well? I mean, those are two other ones?
Correct.
Kidney and liver and gallbladder.
And let's talk about the scientific pathways. Like, what do we know that's going on inside the body of an obese person that makes them more at risk for cancer?
So we know that obese patients are resistant to insulin. That's why they have diabetes. They need to make more insulin. And not only does insulin stimulate your ability to use sugar, but it also stimulates growth of tumors. So that's one pathway that we know that goes on in obese people. The fat tissue, everybody thinks of as a storage tissue for energy when you need it. But in addition to being a storage tissue, it actually makes hormones which go out and either turn off or stimulate tumors to grow. And there's one hormone in particular, I'll get technical, called leptin. And the fat tissue makes leptin. And the more fat tissue you have, the more leptin it makes, because leptin tells your body you've eaten enough, stop. But so, leptin also stimulates tumors to grow.
So leptin is kind of connected with your appetite control? And that
leptin
that
is a normal body mechanism to control appetite. The more fat tissue you have, the more leptin you make. It's supposed to tell you to stop eating. People develop leptin resistance, so you make more leptin to try and control your appetite, and that leptin can stimulate certain tumors, especially breast tumors.
So it sounds like these fat cells essentially become these little factories churning out leptin and other chemicals and hormones that feed cancer cells, literally?
Yeah, and so the one other pathway that's really important is these fat cells become factories that make inflammatory factors. So you normally think that you get inflammation when you get an infection or you get a cut or something like that, but your fat tissue actually makes inflammatory proteins that circulate in your body and stimulate tumor cells to grow.
And Dr. Shepard, what about the role of estrogen? I think people, we talked about estrogen with endometrial cancer. Isn't it also related to breast cancer? And then how do obese women get more estrogen?
Well, I think the key is, as you suggested earlier, fat cells really become a mechanism by which they generate things that drive cancers. Estrogen is an example of that. Fat cells will secrete hormones, including estrogens and androgens, which can be converted to estrogens and drive those cancers that can be dependent upon estrogens.
So the fat cells actually convert other hormones into estrogen,
correct,
which then becomes extra estrogen,
right,
or correct,
too much. And does estrogen stimulate the cancer cells?
Absolutely. So there's a whole series of cancer, obesity-associated cancers in women that are driven by these hormones. So that includes postmenopausal breast cancer, uterine cancer. Now there's a pretty good indication that ovarian cancers and maybe even cervical cancers are all driven by estrogens.
So not only does obesity raise your risk of certain cancers, but it also, people die more, obese people die more of these cancers. What's kind of behind that higher mortality rate?
I think there's a number of factors. One is the fact that the fat tissue, as we've suggested, drives production of things like estrogen that make those tumor cells grow. There's a number of other factors as well. One would be that patients who are obese may not be getting screenings. And so obese women may be more prone to avoid cervical exams, may be more prone to avoid breast mammograms.
So they're diagnosed later.
Diagnosed at a later stage. Men may be less likely to get rectal exams to look for prostate cancer. And so a later stage of diagnosis will automatically set them up for being at higher risk for mortality.
And then what about the treatment? I know, Dr. Shepard, you've talked, like, even dosing chemo with, you know, obese people, that's not how the chemo was designed, so it makes it harder.
Yeah, unfortunately, when we design drugs, chemotherapy drugs in specific, they're oftentimes dosed on a body surface area, taking a look at how much people weigh compared to what their height is. And those studies are done with people within normal weight ranges. And so when you start talking about treating obese people who are outside those weight ranges, we don't know if that drug distributes the same into fat. We don't know if the same dosing is appropriate. As we go to more oral chemotherapies where we have a fixed dose, where you may give 100 milligrams to a patient, I would be giving the same 100 milligrams to a 120-pound patient as a 400-pound patient, and clearly there are differences there, and something probably needs more study.
So they're saying 100,000 deaths a year from cancer related to obesity. How does that stand up against smoking? Is obesity going to overtake smoking for cancer?
So the number of cancer deaths associated with smoking is almost double that, 160,000, 180,000 a year. That's in addition to all the other deaths associated with tobacco use, like lung disease and so on. There definitely is a decrease. I mean, the public has become sensitive to the fact that smoking is causes cancer, and people are smoking less, and we're already seeing a decrease in some of the tobacco-associated cancers. The public is just beginning to become aware. Hopefully this show will help indicate to people that obesity is a real risk factor for cancer, and that people will begin to prevent the development of obesity, which is, you can say, it's sort of akin to preventing to never starting smoking. So hopefully we won't have a crossover of obesity-related cancers and tobacco-related cancers, but it could happen if the obesity rate continues to increase.
And some other messages. I mean, are we at the point where primary care doctors should start talking to patients when they talk to them about, you know, weight and diabetes and heart, maybe bringing up their cancer risk?
Go ahead. I mean, I think that's really going to be key to stemming the tide here. I mean, I think that, you know, really prevention is going to be a really, really important factor. Just like we think obesity leads to heart disease, cardiovascular disease. There has to be that link, and it has to start with primary care. Primary care has to really be pushing for screenings that are appropriate for everyone, but really making sure that obese patients get those screenings.
And is that going, are they talking about cancer risk yet, or is this still too new? It hasn't really trickled down yet?
So a lot of physicians are reluctant to talk about weight control at all. We need more physicians talking to primary care physicians, talking to patients about weight control, prevention. We need more people talking about, more physicians talking to patients about increasing their level of activity, getting longer sleep. We need more pediatricians telling parents that cute fat little babies are going to grow up to be fat, you know, adolescents. And that's going to result in an adult obesity, and in having a 10-year-old obese child is just like having a 10-year-old who started smoking, and you wouldn't stand for that. Hopefully you wouldn't stand for that. And the other thing that we really need to do is we need to have cancer specialists, oncologists, talk to their patients as soon as the diagnosis of cancer does occur. We need to have oncologists talking to their patients about getting more exercise, controlling their weight, and so on, because as you indicated, not only is there a higher incidence, but there's a higher death rate.
And Dr. Shepard, do you see patients, do you talk to them about what you just said, trying to get exercise with the diagnosis? I mean, is that something that's regularly prescribed, so to speak?
Yeah, I think where that becomes most important is as we think more and more about survivorship issues, as patients are living longer and longer after their diagnosis, really, you know, encouraging patients to live a healthier lifestyle, to more exercise, more control over what they eat.
Well, I know in the endometrial patients, they found that exercise actually improved their chances of survival. Is that true with other cancers? The breast, maybe?
So it's very clear that first of all, most women who get a diagnosis of breast cancer and then start on therapy start gaining weight right away, which is exactly the wrong thing to happen. What you'd like those women to do is to exercise more, watch their diet, live a healthier lifestyle, and either lose or control their weight.
And how concerned? I mean, we have this aging baby boomer population, so your cancer risk increases with age. Then we have this obesity epidemic. I mean, we kind of have like a double whammy going on. How concerned should we be?
So we should be very concerned because most cancer, 65-70% of new diagnosis of cancer occurs in patients 65 and older. So cancer, even though all of us have 30-year-old and 50-year-old friends who got cancer, cancer is really a disease of older adults. So we have the increase in the size of the population, we have the increase in the weight of the population, so we really have a perfect storm, a tsunami, so to speak, of aging population, obese population coming together right at the time that they're most susceptible to cancer.
So you're calling it a tsunami?
Correct. It's a perfect storm where our medical institutions are going to be flooded by the amount of cancer, the increase in cancer that we see just because of the increase in the aging population and the increase in obesity coming together at this critical time.
Dr. Shepard, what do you think?
I absolutely agree. And you also overlay the fact that in a lot of other areas of health, cardiovascular risk prevention, things that have made people less likely to die of other causes, they actually now live long enough to get those cancers.
And Dr. Berger, you had some really good things on prevention, and you brought it up with starting in childhood, because some of these cancers take 20 years to develop. So getting good sleep, staying healthy weight, tell me that we kind of need to reframe our cancer prevention messages in some cases?
So the really important lifestyle factors that we can incorporate from early childhood is to get adequate sleep. Most people aren't aware that short sleep, less than 7 hours a night, is actually a risk for cancer. And not only is a risk for developing cancer, but it's a risk for a worse or more virulent form of cancer. So early in childhood, we should really encourage children and continue to encourage them to get more than 7 hours of sleep a night, to eat the right foods, to engage probably in group activities, sports, which will encourage them to continue that on a lifelong basis, and to maintain their weight, and to have less screen time, less time on their
the sedentary lifestyle.
Less of the sedentary lifestyle. All of these are important to developing a healthy lifestyle, along with eliminating tobacco use and controlling alcohol use.
So, Dr. Shepard, do you think throwing cancer into the mix with all these other things that people are bombarded with heart disease and diabetes, do you think throwing cancer into the mix with that puts it in a different light, that people may start paying attention?
Yeah, I think. I think that's absolutely true. I mean, I think you really do have to elevate it to, you know, I think we've gone a long ways. I mean, this used to be something we didn't even talk about, right? If someone in the family had cancer, you didn't even mention it. Now we're actually pulling it to the forefront and saying, look, you have to do the right things to prevent getting cancer, right? And so I think we've come a long way, but now we need to go further. We need to work on, as you say, very early in life, think about what can I do to minimize risk for cancer.
And you said if you were going to tell your 8-year-old not to smoke, well, tell him now not to be overweight. That's powerful.
Right.
Well, I appreciate you both coming in and sharing your expertise on this. Thanks.
Thank you for doing this.